Welcome to our Dominoes countdown to game time. We are so close to our first match today, and of course that matchup is going to be between EnVyUs and Splyce. So let's take a little bit of a deeper dive on these two teams here. We'll start out with EnVyUs, and DP, why don't you tell me everything worth knowing about these boys?
EnVyUs has been the main juggernaut in the Overwatch scene for a very long time, and it goes back before even their EnVyUs days. Their core was a team known as IDDQD, and pretty much all they do in Overwatch is win. They have had the most sterling record. They had a big falling out, though, at Gamescom, where they lost to Rogue, but still, they're a juggernaut. You look at the NA groups here, they were the first to qualify. They got in first week, and they're the team where everyone just sort of goes, oh man, we're going up against these guys. So you want to talk about the players on it. Taimu, perhaps one of the most devastating, if not the most devastating, scan player in the game. Tailspin, FPS veteran, has been dominant in every non-CS FPS game that's been out there and around, and has brought his skills here to Overwatch. They're just stacked, and that's even without going to their tank and support core, which truly makes the team. So for EnVyUs, they're a juggernaut.
Yeah, talking to a lot of the support players and asking them, you know, who they look up to, a lot of them looking up to these EnVyUs supports. Harry Hook is at the top of the list. We got a great lineup on EnVyUs, and Splyce is a lineup that I think a lot of people are a little less familiar with. So, Chris, tell me what you know about these guys.
Well, they're new to Overwatch, but they're not new to eSports. So, in general, these guys are veterans of different, you know, different games doing different things. We even had a StarCraft player in there, a former StarCraft player in Sickness. Overall, I think this is going to be a test for them. This is the Crucible. This is where, you know, you see, are those nerfs going to come into play? This is a big stage. This is a big tournament, the biggest one they've been in. And honestly, they haven't had the same preparation that EnVyUs have had. EnVyUs have been boot camping for 2 weeks. And Splyce, on the other hand, they haven't had a practice partner, you know? They've definitely practiced more. They've been doing twice a day, as far as I've heard. So they're practicing a lot more. But when you don't have that committed partner and you're honestly a tier two team, you know, they aren't with the big dogs yet. This is just going to be a test for them. And I think overall, they're either going to come and they're going to make it a close match, or they're not. But they have to keep their head in the game, because this is going to be a long day for them.
Anything you wanted to add to that, ZP?
I guess one thing I'd say about Splyce is that there have been some warning flags about them recently, too. It was one of the recent weekly tournaments where they actually fell to a Korean team in LW Red, where LW Red looked great, but Splyce dropped 5 games to them. So we have less info on Envy in the aftermath of Gamescom, but from what we've seen at Splyce, they still have answers that they need to find, and I'm not sure they've found them here, but it's always hopeful. We are in person. We are here. And anything can happen. There's always craziness that happens when you bring people to an event like this.
It's the hot seat, you know? Yeah. If you're a pro gamer, you're here. A lot of players play a lot better online, and some play better at LAN. And if they have a couple players that can actually do that, if they're in that hot seat and they perform and they're one of those dogs that just go out and get it, they could have a great team. But, I mean, first match going up against EnVyUs, that's rough.
I would say that if there's any key to Splyce's victory here is that Clockwork has real explosiveness. He was dominant in other games that he played in the past, and I think he's the type of player that gets better the more hours he puts into the game. So even though he might have started out in Overwatch not super dominant, he's been getting better and better. And if there's a victory here for Splyce today, I think it goes through Clockwork.
Well, earlier today, Malik actually got to talk to Clockwork before the match, so let's check out what they had to say.
Thank you very much, guys. I'm here with Clockwork from Team Splyce. Clockwork, tell me about the team's preparation going into the tournament.
So we didn't have a boot camp like other teams did. We had a few roster issues. Kozen, our original support, was a little too much time than I think he had thought it would be. So we got Nick to replace him. And Shane, our tank, he has a current career in UPS that he really can't take off for video games. So he's a temporary too, like into this event. So it's been a little shaky. We've tried to see what we can do with these kind of temporary fixes, but feeling kind of confident.
Gotcha. So pretty much everyone has like their full-time jobs that they're dealing with, and it kind of affects you guys from a practice standpoint.
Yeah. Sickness has, he has a part-time job. Well, he was full-time, took time off to pursue this. A lot of us do take this as a full-time thing. I mean, I take it as a full-time thing. I think almost everyone but Sickness and Shane at this point take it as a full-time thing. So we definitely have a lot of time to prepare.
Gotcha. Now, we have Team EnVyUs you guys are going to be facing off with. We haven't seen anything that they've done. We haven't seen them play since the Atlantic Showdown. So how did you guys prepare to play against them?
We've actually scrimmed them a little bit. We were always pretty good against them in scrims. We kind of played better than we had expected, because, you know, even the first time we played them, we were like, they're the best team in the world. You know, this is But we actually took, you know, a lot of good rounds off, and we won a few of the scrims, I think, if I remember correctly. So feeling pretty good. I know a couple of the guys on EnVyUs, like Taimu used to play TF2 with me. Not with me, but also used to play TF2. So I know a couple of guys, kind of familiar with them a bit. So I'm feeling a little bit confident, more than I would be otherwise, definitely.
So is he who you're looking out for on the other tour? Is there anybody else from EnVyUs that you're kind of like looking at? Like, that could be a possible threat.
Taimu's always a threat. I always thought Tailspin was super good. You know, I've been somewhat familiar with him because I played a little bit of Shoot Mania when he used to play Shoot Mania, and he was really good at that game, you know, kind of impressed me. So I always knew he was like a good gamer. So definitely Taimu, definitely Tailspin, but their supports are crazy too. It's just the whole team has, they're all a threat, really.
Excellent, man. All right, well, best of luck to you and the rest of the team. And we're going to kick it back to the guys at the desk. Thank you very much, man.
Yeah, most interesting about these players is how many times and how many different games they faced each other on, but they've never had a battle like this one here today at the Overwatch Open. And the battlegrounds are about to be decided as we choose our maps. So first up, we're gonna see Numbani, and then it's gonna be our loser's pick, so we could be either headed to Nepal or King's Row. Now, I know you guys are my resident desk experts, and I appreciate all your contributions throughout the match, but there's another pair in this room that is going to carry us through the action, and I think it's time we meet them. What do you guys say?
Nah, okay.
Yeah, Chris is like, no, more camera time for me.
Sure.
keep it over here.
We actually have two wonderful casters over in our booth. We've got Semmler and Anders. Guys, you're looking so handsome. I love those smiles, but what do you think about these maps?
Actually, they don't need to see us, Anders. You know, just bring it down. Huck has actually got control of the lights over there under the desk. He's like, actually, we don't need to talk to these guys at all. But how are you feeling, man? You feeling good about being here?
Yeah, oh, definitely. I mean, it's going to be a rough start. Definitely, as the desk was saying, Splyce, I think, are going to be up for a really tough time. But I'm always in the mood for an upset, you know?
It's exactly, man. And that's the thing. I mean, one point, and it's always like a little bit of a cliche point, but they have nothing to lose, right? Mm-hmm. It's Envy who are playing, you know, not to lose.
They have all the
pressure. Yeah. Splyce are here. This is their first time on location being able to play, you know, in this kind of environment. And so they shouldn't be feeling any pressure right now because it's just like everybody expects them to lose. So now just unleash, right? If you have a pocket strat that's going to catch Envy off guard, now's the time to use it.
And that's the exact point that Rogue used at GamesCon. You know, mm-hmm. They interviewed them before they upset them, and they're like, how are you guys viewing this matchup? And they're like, you know what? Pressure's on them. They have to come in here, and I think EnVyUs have to set the pace. You know, yeah. If they lose here, I mean, that's a pretty rough start.
To talk about the Rogue example, too, some players just step up hugely at LAN. AKM, probably the best example, where
exactly. He
did super, super well when he got to that in-person environment. And not every player can do that. Some players play up, and you never know what's going to happen when you put teams right here in the studio.
So I hope you guys learned a lot from our very talkative analysts in this segment when we're meant to know the casters. But, you know, we're going to hear a lot more from Anders and Semmler as these games get underway. Thank you so much, guys, for saying hello. And in the meantime, Chris, Andy, do you have predictions for this matchup?
EnVyUs. I mean, it's.
Is that a 2-0?
I mean, it's more than likely. I think if Splyce walked away from this and they took a map, they would be happy. I think they could look at the rest of this group and say, you know what? Good enough for us. We can probably make it out second. But at this point, I think you're just looking at it like this is the meat grinder. Let's kind of just get in there and see what happens.
You go by history. Just going all the way back, and you go by recent history with Splyce's performances against LW Red, you must give this to EnVyUs. But again, there is always volatility in this sort of environment. And hey, I mean, we're starting out here with Numbani. Numbani is where weird upsets can happen. It's the lab of Overwatch. And if there is a place where Splyce could pull out a pocket strategy and really surprise us, I think it would be here. So I'm excited to see what happens.
All right, we got a lot of action ahead of us as we head into the game, guys. I'm going to hand it over to our casters for a quick map fly through, and then we'll get into the action.
All right, thank you so much, guys, at the desk. Rachel as well. So, I mean, now we're about to get into our first map here on location, and it's going to be Numbani, Anders. Now, this is one of the more interesting maps in the pool just because it's a hybrid map. It involves different mechanics, right? Some maps involve just pushing a payload from one point of the map to the other. Some maps involve only catching points. This one, you have a bit of both. You have to catch the point before you can actually push that payload and get this map win. So we'll see who's going to be starting on the offense, who on the defense.
Yeah, I'm very excited about this first game here coming up. I think it's going to be interesting. That first point here on Umbani, I think it's going to be, I think it's almost always capped. I feel like it's hard to hold that first one. There's so many different sort of level advantages on this one. It's hard for the defending team to just hold the high ground on this one, like you can on some other maps where you can just control the high ground early on. In this one, it's going to be tricky to stop the opposing team from doing that. And yeah, it looks like it's going to be Envy defending first of all, and then Splyce are going to be on the offensive.
Really interesting to see which way they're going to go with this one. And it looks like Envy, they are straight, just going straight for it, right? The current meta, it seems, which is to go tank heavy and then have the Ana backing them up. So Tailspin on the Mei, Coco on the Zarya.
Well, it's worse, actually, than the desk is introducing, because they were introducing the 3-3 metagame, and already here we've got the 4-2-1 instead. We've got Ana and obviously, yeah, Lucio playing there, and then we've got the four tanks basically playing Mei, helping out a little bit, which is exceptional. I love that.
Which is on the offense, right? Like, that's going to be Splyce's game, basically. Splyce are just, they're going to try, they obviously know that there's going to be this choke point, this high ground advantage, right, that EnVyUs are going to be trying to look for. EnVyUs, the goal for them is to try and get Splyce to wrap. Either pick your poison, right? You got to either wrap around on the side towards the balconies or come up the main road, because otherwise you're running right into the tanks. Splyce, though, they're like, great, we got tanks, four of them. So how are you going to deal with it, Envy? Because Ana, if you do any damage to us, Ana's going to be getting her ultimate that much faster. And so it's a bit of a trick now for Envy to be able to just try and keep Splyce at bay.
It's a lot of HP on the map right now. It could be a while before they actually get anybody killed. What a great wall being put up there by Tailspin, zoning out the enemy team coming in, and now he's trying for with the ice gun, but not quite making it work. Taimu gonna pick up the first kill on Sickness, and now we're off to the races here. Second kill coming in, and Splyce not making a lot of progress right now, losing players left and right, and this push is going to be entirely destroyed. Shrugger even doing a pretty good job at the end there, actually not killing him too fast. If you can, you'd much rather just sort of stagger the enemy, respawn a little bit, make sure you keep him alive at the end. So no luck at all for Splyce in the first push.
No, this is just, that was just beautiful work from Tailspin. He hit that timing perfectly. Splyce maybe feeling a little bit of the nerves there, tried to push in, tried to really take the fight to Envy. Tailspin's like, great, I'm gonna cut your team in half. Your Ana's on the wrong side of that wall. She's not getting energy by trying to heal up these tanks. Instead, my team are just going to completely collapse and collapse rather onto the offense. And so, EnVyUs, that was a perfect hold from them. And Chips, he's got the ult already.
A look at Splyce. They actually swap out characters almost immediately here. The hero's already out. We've got McCree now playing. We've got Sickness on the D.Va as well. So already there's a big change. After just one push, they squash that and they want to move on and see if they can make it happen here. Really good Ana ult already coming in there. Into the hole, charging through and dropping here. So he's wrecking them. It's going to be a triple kill. All of them going down. And Splyce, that's 0-2 right now.
And that's where it's so difficult about dealing with this kind of push, is that you have to get that sleep. You have to get some form of CC. And teams are still trying to figure out how to actually lock down that boosted character, right? That hero, when he's charged up and running at your face, he takes less damage, he deals more damage, he moves faster. He just turns into a juggernaut, to steal the word from ZP there. So, I mean, now it's going to be Splyce's turn to get into the action. They'll have their juggernaut. We'll see how they use him.
Already in this, Shane, he has got the Shatter. We'll see if he can make it work, but he's actually going to be going down. That's such a shame. Now, how do they push without that? It's such a huge ultimate here in Overwatch. You need that to pretty much set up a nice team fight. And, I mean, again, it seems like every time Splyce lose a fight, they swap out somebody else. Now, Shrugger's playing on the Genji instead, which I really like just from watching the previous matches. He seems to be quite good at playing the DPS. I thought maybe even he would try and go for like an early Reaper or something, but he's actually started out on Winston, which is a little bit funny even.
Yeah, now they're trying to go back to what's an old tried and true, right? Get that 2-2-2 going. And so, I mean, we have to see. He's got his ultimate now. We could get that boost going on him. Pure, he's got his nano boost ready, and we're waiting to see where the ults are going to come out here, because Splyce are just pushing into the blender.
Sickness very low as well. He's going to be out of it any second now. Only one kill happening right now in favor of Splyce, and that's Zarya going down on Coco there. But right now, I mean, this is, we were warned, our analysts did say this could well be what's in store right here. Envy looking incredibly on point here. We're only talking about the first point. They haven't even got the payload started on this hybrid map here. So just a really tough way to get started if you are Splyce.
Exactly. And now, I mean, Pure, they did actually get the advantage in ults for a moment, but then obviously you gain energy over time without having to deal any damage or get any heals, right? And so Taimu, he's got his ult now. Internet Hulk on the Winston, he has his as well. And so there's a lot, it's fairly balanced now, and there just isn't enough time. 20 seconds left for Splyce to make the push and try and get control of this point.
The one thing is that Zarya on Envy he doesn't have the Graviton Surge, so he can they could take a fight right now where Shane has the Earth Shatter and they don't have much to counter it with, and that would obviously be incredible sickness jumping out there, activating the ultimate, but all of Envy just scattering, not even getting hit by it. And you're right, we're almost at the last stage here. It seems like maybe Splyce are gonna get shot down without taking any points. Taimu picking up two big kills and Tailspin and Instant Hold. They are gonna be going down, so a little bit working up, but Taimu doing even more damage, and Splyce now they're in overtime trying to see if they can stay alive right here. And it's gonna be really rough. The respawns are coming in as well, and Saria with the damage as well. There's almost no chance. Trying to activate the overtime again. Sickness the only one trying to stay alive and just buy more time, but it doesn't seem like it's gonna happen at all. What a performance from Envy early on. He's actually gonna be able to resuit again. It's pretty incredible. He's staying alive for a very, very long time here. The sickness eventually will go down, and that's gonna be the end of the first round here. Just already out of it.
Yeah, just what fantastic positioning. I mean, it's at the start, really, where Envy, they're keeping close to the doors. They're immediately able to drop out as soon as the D.Va ult comes in. I mean, that's a massive AoE damage. That's why you're looking to try and break the line of sight. You want to get around a corner, hide from it. And Envy, not a single one caught out in the open, and I think that was the turning point. Because at that point, you basically, oh, you collapse back on, and you start picking Splyce apart. Obviously, Splyce, yeah, you commented on it, right? D.Va, she was doing a fantastic job of staying alive. That's pretty much her strong point. She's excellent at stalling things out. But you kind of need the rest of your teammates to survive as well and actually do some damage.
Yeah, I'm shocked that Shane couldn't get one of the good Earth Shatters down. I feel like that would have set them up so nicely. But maybe we should give some credit to Envy instead. They were never really positionally in a place where they could easily get Earth Shattered. He wasn't going to get like four or five people with that Earth Shatter. And because they kept lacking their own sort of Saria ultimate, they were just in a really rough spot pretty much all throughout.
I just had this image of EnVyUs as like a school of fish, right? And Splyce, you know, they're desperately thrashing around trying to get a mouthful, right, of that school of fish. And EnVyUs, man, they're just swarming around them perfectly, regroup when they need to, but split up when the D.Va comes in, for example. I mean, not a problem for Envy. They're just so on point. And well, so now, I mean, now obviously things are going to flip. It's going to be Splyce's turn to try and defend this point, and we'll see just what EnVyUs are capable of. Curious to see if Tailspin is going to stick on that far.
Something I love here is actually Harry Hook picking up the Mercy already, because that's going to be interesting. This is definitely the first point here. Think about how much he can hide behind and just come out with a revive and one good revive, and that's pretty much going to be it. And then we've got Tailspin as well on the DPS, so we do have a 3-2-1 setup for Envy, and Splyce has sort of reset themselves into the 4-2. And it's going to be a little bit interesting. Four tanks, essentially, and then the two supports here on Ninja Nick and Pure. I Envy, they just need one good fight, and this is going to be done with the first map.
Interesting decision, Splyce taking up a different defensive position than EnVyUs did in their defense. They're holding on the other balcony across from the other side of the site, and so we'll see if EnVyUs are going to be allowed to get in here and try and put up a fight for that high ground. We're following Tailspin right now. He's looking to try and get that flank going. And he does have a couple of teammates backing him up. But this is all about timing now, and there we go. There's the info, and immediately Tailspin tries to knock them off the balcony, but it's not going to work.
You see how well he reads that. He knows they're going to try and get that high ground advantage. We know it's so important in Overwatch. He actually pre-fired that grenade just to get there. Now they're going to go for the fight here. They're taking a little bit of damage using the Concussive Blast to get away from the wall and just back up from that lightning gun on the Winston on the other side. Tailspin really trying to land these shots, but actually missing quite a few of them. They are still going to get a bunch of kills in here. Sickness and Shane already down. That's two big heroes that are not going to have a chance to get their ults off. And Pure also going down. This is not looking good. Envy just staying alive and Tailspin wreaking havoc. He's 7% away from getting the ult. There's the ult, and that's really going to be it. There's nothing they can do. They're trying to get back in, but running right into the ultimate. Tailspin, an absolute monster.
Yeah, that was so sick by Tailspin. He's just like, I don't need to go and deal with the guys on the point. I can trust in my teammates to handle the job there. Instead, I'm just going to completely cut them out at the knees. And really, I mean, now we're seeing the difference in caliber, right, of Envy, who made the grand finals of the last, you know, event competition that was held for Overwatch, went up against Rogue. I mean, they have the experience here. They clearly have the game plan. Splyce definitely looking a little nervous.
You see, it was actually quite cool because you see Envy, I almost thought they were going to overcommit to taking the high ground. You're actually right. He tried with the Concussive Blast to push them all off. Mm-hmm. When that failed, they sort of went for it, and then it looked like they were going to overcommit. They were taking a lot of damage from the lightning gun on the enemy Winston, and then they actually fell back and sort of managed to stay alive and recommit into it. That's not so easy. If only half the team falls back and half of them are still fighting, if there's any like miscommunication in the team there, then that fight's going to fall apart for them, and they'll lose, you know, they probably will lose Tailspin up on the high ground early on.
It's Winston, you know, he's the guy who can actually close the gap. What Reinhardt, you're not going to swing your hammer and, you know, try and swat Pharah out of the air. It's just not going to work, right? There wasn't that much poke to be able to deal with the Pharah, who just survived forever.
Right, and speaking of that, because they have the Mercy as well, it's sort of a return to a meta that's just a little bit earlier with the damage boosted Pharah. Mm-hmm. Those rockets are so brutal if you hit them perfectly.
Oh, we were following him at the right time. He was just hitting rocket after rocket. It's just so much damage. And so, I mean, EnVyUs, definitely, you tune in, you expect to see these guys innovate. You expect to see them just be like, right, this is the meta right now. This is what you guys are doing. Hold on, let's demonstrate how you actually crack this all open.
That one there that we just saw the replay of the nano-boosted ultimate Winston is just, what do you even do at that point? It actually is a legit question. What do you do? Because finding him is almost never an option, right? So you got to find a way to zone him out and back off and keep your teammates alive and just wait for it to sort of run down a little bit. Otherwise, you're going to be in so much trouble.
And that was the nightmare because Anna came in. She got the sleep, but she got the sleep after three of her teammates were dead, right? It's just a little bit too late. Justin Loach, I am Cyber Waste. Okay, then. And he's on Twitter talking to us here. And the Envy we know, and love, treading all over the snake of Splyce. That's right. They went for the head, right? And just cut it off.
That's definitely not wrong. And apparently King's Row is going to be the second map. I think the losers get to choose the second map out of the map pool.
That's correct, works. Yes.
One of the most popular maps in competitive Overwatch. For Korea, everyone, I feel like, knows how to play King's Row. And that's going to be rough. That's another map where you sort of need to take the first point, and then you activate the payload and try and push it on through. So very interesting. I think Splyce, I mean, what do you even take away from that in the beginning? What do you learn in that very short time when you're fighting? The one thing that I can't figure out if this is a strength or a weakness, but if you try and run a setup, remember Splyce when they were on the offensive, mm-hmm. They started off with a 4-2, and then the very second it failed, they instantly swapped out and tried something else. Now, that could be a sign of, you know, being a very dynamic team. You're able to sort of switch out of something that isn't working if they identify that it's not working, but it could also be just, you know, chaos, right? It could be too much. It could be at a point in time where you say, well, you didn't even get a chance, you know?
I think it could also be a question of just confidence, right? I mean, clockwork on your screen right now, he was talking about the fact that they had a difficult time coming to this tournament, actually getting proper practice done, roster changes, all sorts. So they haven't really had the time to fine-tune their machine the way that Envy have right? Yeah. 2 weeks of preparation for Envy coming into this tournament. They're going to know what they're comfortable with, what strats work, whereas yeah. Splyce, you're right to point it out. If something doesn't work, they're like, why is it not working? Okay, hold on, let's go back to something that may work right or something that's bread and butter. And so it's that kind of hesitation that's actually going to cost Splyce in the long term.
Yeah, and like we sort of had the interviews going in from Malik, right? And it did definitely seem like they were, I mean, maybe lacked a little bit of focus. Some of their players, you know, having full-time jobs next to it. And yeah. That's going to be rough, I think, in Overwatch, especially going forward. You know, if you look into sort of a year into the future, right? Mm-hmm. Having the ability to have an in-game leader who can make a really quick call and say, this is exactly why we're losing. Like, this one swap will win us the next team fight. But if it's just an individual call where someone says, I'm not feeling too well playing this hero right now, I'm going to try and swap out and play something else instead, then there's no team, there's no plan, you know, there's no overarching plan. And I feel like you need that. Another thing that you brought up, actually, which I just want to reiterate, is this idea that even when they were losing the fights, you can kind of justify losing the fight if you at least come out with the ult advantage, right? If you say, well, we're setting ourselves up for the next fight, because next time we will have 4 or 5 ults, they will only have 2, so we're probably going to do it. That Splyce didn't even manage that, and that's going to be rough, real rough for them.
Yeah, that was the point, actually, where I was like, okay, going into the push at 40 seconds, oh, well, they have 3 ults, Envy have 2, and then, unfortunately, they were high enough Envy to be able to just match things up, and from there on out, it was definitely one side. I mean, the fun thing is, it's just Overwatch, right? The scene and how quickly it's growing. It is interesting to see. You know, we're so used to it in other scenes where pros, right? They're salaried. It's their full-time occupation. They train all day, yep. Right? You know, and it's just showing that Overwatch has a little bit of catching up to do in the sense that, you know, some of the players are still working part-time. You know, they've only been pro or semi-pro for just a few months now. And so it's going to be great. I mean, really exciting times, right? We're at the very beginning here, and we're going to be able to just follow all of these stories as they develop.
I'm gonna put you on the spot, Semmler. What's your favorite hero in this game? You know, this is one of those questions where you could get in real trouble. You know?
No, not at all. I mean, right now, because I'm solo queuing, bro. Like I did it in CS.
Why are you doing that?
I'm like, I did it in CS. I did it in CS. If I could do it in CS, I could do it in Overwatch.
All right.
Problem is that it's actually physically painful, and so I think I've just kind of cringed back, and I'm like, okay, I'll play Tracer.
Because at least Tracer, you can have an impact.
Yeah.
And you can you can semi-carry with Tracer if you play it well enough, right? And so I'm going to Tracer right now. So Tracer's my favorite.
That's fair enough. I think that's a safe pick. I think most people won't grill you too badly for that. You can have a big sort of individual impact with that one.
Tracer's just the most fun because if you can get in there, I mean, you're harassing the back line. And if your teammates are right aware enough, you know, if you're keeping the back line busy, they should be able to take advantage of the front line, get an advantage there. Sometimes it doesn't work, but I've had a lot of fun playing Tracer, so she's my go-to right now.
All right. I don't blame you. I don't blame
what
you.
What about you, Anders? Well, I mean, Anders, I know what your favorite hero is.
It's changed a little bit, actually.
It's now only that natural, right? I'm French. She's French. You know, I can see how it works out in your mind, right? Subconscious. Yeah,
I should say Widowmaker, but just you know, to protect myself, I'm not going to do that. I know people are going to tweet and complain about it. Actually, from watching the game, I really like watching Mei. I think Mei's like mechanics are so much fun. You saw the first ice wall that went up early on. I can't remember if it was Time or Tailspin, but the first wall that went up, the very first push that they just did, they zoned them out. They almost practically lost the fight in that one ice wall, and that's so cool. Now we're gonna head into King's Row. And as our second map with Envy already winning the first one. If you aren't just joining us, then a big welcome here to the Overwatch Open. We are in Atlanta. And this is already a bit of a one-sided match, as both Chris and Andrew were predicting.
Yeah, that's the main thing. I mean, there's no reason to beat around the bush in this sort of scenario. EnVyUs, they have so much experience. They've definitely been a dominant force for quite some time in the competitive Overwatch scene. Splyce, they're still up and coming. You know, they're clearly the underdog in this match. And so EnVyUs, they handily took the first map. And so we go into the second. This is a best of three as well, just to be clear. And so Envy, they only need one map win to progress further into the tournament, whereas Splyce, I mean, they just have to battle tooth and nail here to stop from dropping down into that loser match.
I'm excited. Tailspin actually has picked up the Widowmaker early on. And since they are on the offense, this is so easy for him to do as well, because all he has to do is he can land like one or two shots, and if it's not working out, he can just easily swap out in the spawn, right? He can just take that shot and swap it right back. So that's not even a risk. Taimu also on the hunt, so it's not impossible that he will just put out the Sonic Arrow and then and then swap out immediately afterwards to something else. I am happy, though, that that Splyce are running the 3-3 that we've been talking about. It feels like it's planned, you know. We introduced this, the so-called NiP metagame, and that's exactly what they're doing on the Splyce side, so we're going to be off in 5 seconds.
I mean, it's just about having HP, having health points, right? You want to defend the point, you want to be as difficult to kill as possible, and so that's the whole goal here, is to try and set that up, and we'll see if Splyce can manage it. EnVyUs, they do have Tailspin on the Tracer, so she's going to be looking to find that flank angle. And in the meantime, it is just going to be a straight-up push off the high ground, straight over the wall, avoiding the choke, and right onto the point. Coco's not wasting any time at all.
Oh, he's going to go for the charge, but he didn't catch anyone, so now he's sort of behind enemy lines, has to get back, help out his teammates a little bit. Envy fighting for it, and no one has gone down yet. I don't know how Coco's still alive. It feels like he should have been shot in the back at least a couple of times. There's the hook coming in, and he's very low on health. Ends up going down, Tailspin actually is the one going down on Tracer, but he does have his ult, so when he's back in the fight, it's going to be interesting. Internet ult back in it, and a nice hook from Clockwork. It looks like Splyce are actually defending, and they're building a lot of ult already.
Yeah, no, that barrier coming out from, I mean, you can see some sick play coming out here from Internet Hulk. I mean, he's just like, right, go in, Coco, because I've got barriers for you all day long. And so he's just, I mean, it's that relationship with Zarya, all of her forward dive heavy kind of characters or heroes that she's going to be backing up. She's going to be there with that barrier. It's going to be very difficult. But look at this. There's the boost, and already Taimu just charging in, and he's just doing so much damage. Clockwork gone in the blink of an eye, and he's looking for Genji. Not Genji. Zenyatta, obviously.
Look at that. I mean, Taimu, Nano Booster Reaper. It's going to make actually aiming a little bit more difficult, but when you have players like Taimu and also Tailspin on this team, you know they're going to be able to do it. That's incredibly brutal. Takes them out pretty much instantaneously. So Splyce holding off for like half a push, and then they just can't keep it. Now we'll see what they could do here in the street section of the map. They got to try and slow down that payload as much as they can.
They are getting close to ultimates on Ninja Nick, for example. He's up to 90% now. Clockwork is going to have Whole Hog pretty soon here as well, and Sickness with the Zarya ults. I mean, yeah, we're going to have a bunch of ults here for Splyce. They're going to be looking to take advantage of this because EnVyUs did have to use a few ults, obviously, to crack onto that point. And so we'll see. Internet Hulk, he's got the Graviton ready, and we'll see if he decides to use it. Nice dodge there using the angle to avoid the Earth Shatter, and this is all about dealing damage, and he gets the kill on Shane.
building that charge. Look at that, up to 90% practically. So he's dishing out a lot of damage. Hasn't used his ult yet. And in fact, they're losing three players and more falling on Splyce right now. EnVyUs, they just cannot be stopped. Their positional play is just so good. You're right, they're using the map architecture there to just make sure they're dodging as many of Splyce's abilities as possible. And Taimu, he's got something dreadful in mind here. He's ready to bring the pain right onto Splyce on that high ground.
He's looking to punish it, right? Because Splyce are looking to take a fight as early as possible so that they can get back here to challenge the point. And there we go, this is all about it. Taimu, he gets dodged. It's Tailspin instead picking up two kills, with Coco picking up one on Shane. But that was a good read on Splyce's part. They saw Taimu coming from a mile away, but still, it's not going to change anything. EnVyUs are just powering forward here. There's no stopping Tailspin.
It's not only the surprise factor of being on the high ground and that sort of forward up, it's obviously the combination with the Graviton Surge from Internet Hulk that just sets that fight up so incredibly well. I don't know what Splyce could have done to stop that. So now Envy just charging through the map. They're going to set an incredible time here on King's Row. Nice Earth Shatter coming out and then following up with the Nano Boost, the Hammer just going in on them. Splyce, they just can't keep six people alive for more than a couple of seconds at a time.
No, it's just too much damage coming out from EnVyUs. And EnVyUs, they're just sticking together as this unit. So you take advantage of the barrier that's put up by Reinhardt. He's got his shield wall going, and then that sets it up for Taimu on the Reaper to go for the backstab. And this is just looking clean cut here for EnVyUs. They're just indomitable at this point, pushing forward.
Just there's no end to this now. I mean, it's going to be overtime hole, but not even that. There's no one left. Taimu picking up the last three kills with the Reaper, and Envy setting a frankly a stunning time on this map. I don't know how Splyce could summon any kind of motivation to try and fight this. This is going to be so tough.
Exactly right. I mean, it's pretty much a flawless run here for Envy, just completely and utterly destroying Splyce at every turn in every team fight. Even when Splyce had ult advantage, doesn't matter, because EnVyUs were so good about exactly using walls to block it off, making it difficult so that you aren't able to get off that wombo combo on Splyce. You're thinking, we've got five ults. If we just chain them together this way, we'll wipe them out, right? No, EnVyUs are just way too quick. They never got caught off guard.
I mean, if you had to point your finger at like one point in the first fight there where maybe Splyce had, you know, something they could try and exploit, it's probably the fact that the charge is missed on the Reinhardt coming in. That makes you think, all right, now he's zoned out from the rest of his team, and also his team can't sort of hide behind the shield. But they couldn't even really sort of capitalize on that. They weren't able to bring it back even off of that. Envy, I mean, predictably so, everyone said so, they were going to be strong, but this is something else.
Yeah, it's just no respect. And it's good of you to bring that up, right? No respect, just straight charge in. And, you know, right? Just like, I don't care. YOLO, get in there, look for the fight, and don't let Splyce find any ounce of confidence, right, to be able to take the fight back.
There's one odd thing I actually noticed, because you know they had Hanzo early on to just set, and Splyce have the same thing. But none of them are running a Roadhog in the beginning, and normally you'd want that, you know, the Sonic Arrow just to get a good hook in. That's so nice, you know, you got the sort of partial wall hack in, so you can easily land the hook. But what do they really have that can? I mean, obviously they could put out just some raw damage at the beginning, but that Sonic Arrow, I don't think it's gonna help them too much. But it's kind of worth doing anyway, you know. It's just to point out they don't have like a big follow up behind it.
No, they exactly that kind of combo play where you're playing off of each other's abilities. But Splyce on the defense, well, no, on the offense, my mistake. It's going to be EnVyUs on the defense now. And Tailspin, once again, going for the May. And he was so good at hitting those walls, at really cutting up the offense. Splyce trying to push in. That May timing with the wall is going to be so difficult for them to deal with. And they're just trying to wrap, it looks like. They're just going to try and dodge the choke points and see if they can get control of the high ground the same way that EnVyUs did when they were on the offense to begin with.
Shrugger going to be playing on the Reaper. Quite like that. I hope he has some good opportunities here. They got to set him up nicely for it. They're taking the high ground through the apartment there and coming out. And I really love that play. That's actually very intelligent. And Shrugger coming in for it. He's hitting these shots, but he's going to get slept. And now ends up going down. Harry Hook with the kill as well. And if they can't defend this early on here, and then, I mean, they're going to be in a decent position, Splyce, if they can take this cap very, very quickly. Sickness dishing out damage, but he's going to end up going down. And Envy only losing Coco so far.
This is just deathmatch at this point, man. They're all split up. They're all just looking for duels. EnVyUs doing a good job of playing off of each other. Chip saying with the key sleep there, you're right, to shut down that Reaper that was trying to charge him. And from there on out, it just like it's just EnVyUs setting up positions where they're fighting 2v3 or 3v2, right? Or they have the man advantage.
You've got to appreciate Splyce taking the apartment's way in, because if they can guess, if they've already sort of realized that Tailspin is going to be playing on the May, then if they run in through the main entrance, that wall is going to go up again to zone them out. So it's actually quite smart that they try and dodge it, and looks like they're doing the exact same thing. Taimu coming through again, nano boosted, but a counter nano boost coming out, and then the ult coming through. Taimu actually not doing that much damage, having the wall block them up, and Shane getting two good kills in. Taimu having a chance to reload and doing a little bit more. Splyce, just three people left alive right now. EnVy, they only have Taimu and Internet Hulk here to try and see if they can push through. It's not happening.
It's not actually going to be... They might actually pull this off, Splyce. Are we going to get a point cap here for them? Can EnVyUs get back in time? And it doesn't look like it. EnVyUs are not even interested. They're going to control the choke point now and try and slow Splyce up. And really what they want to try and do here, EnVyUs, is get that fight early on. Challenge Splyce while the cart isn't too far pushed forward so that they can get a second fight if they end up resetting.
It's already taking too long, essentially, for Splyce. They're so swiftly running out of time here, but obviously they can try and see if they can just run in through EnVy. They can just hold this, but at least Splyce managed to get a point. Unlike on the first map, when we were on Numbani, they didn't make any impact at all. This time, they've done a bit more.
And here we go. Here's the push coming in from EnVyUs. Leading the way, Coco. He's got his Earth Shatter ready as well, so we'll see when he decides to go for the trigger. There it is! But a great dodge coming in from Sickness. Gets the Graviton Surge down, and there's the AoE damage, just pumping it out. EnVyUs, though, they're hanging in there.
Incredible stuff coming out right now. I don't know why that Graviton Surge didn't do much. He wasn't that much charged, so he couldn't even put out a lot of damage. And Internet Hulk picking up two big kills. EnVy fighting back. And are they going to let him escape? This is sort of a critical point. All right, the respawn is coming in behind him, but you can understand why EnVy would want to try and chase him down, just make sure that Shane respawns out of sync with the rest of his team, but at least they prevented that. Now Shrugger behind here, and he's got the Death Blossom.
Let's see if he can actually create some opportunity here for his teammates. Just trying to charge in. There's the Death Blossom, and he's getting two kills. EnVyUs, they're getting picked off. But then the main core group is still alive, and Shrugger, is he going to be long for this world? He's trying to get back to his teammates, trying to stay alive. And it looks like he'll just barely manage it.
I like how Shrugger tried to keep up that fight against the Mei right up until the shield went up from Internet Hulk, and that was going to be the end of it. Now he's pushing through, nano boosted here. So actually, it's Splyce picking up on that idea of nano boosting the Reaper and trying to see if they can make that work. They are making progress across the map, and you got to wonder if it's in time. They're so close to being out of time, I reckon. Right now, Clockwork going to get a kill on Coco, but still Splyce pushing in, actually doing a really good job there. Mei should be going down, but somehow still alive.
Oh, and he just barely dodges the high noon. But now they actually have the boost going on Taimu. He's the one doing the damage. He just needs to hit some headshots here, but he can't seem to connect on Clockwork. He will hit one. But so far, a successful defense coming in here for EnVy is buying valuable time. 2:20 left on the clock here for Splyce. So they still have plenty of time to work with here, but EnVyUs, they are definitely having to work a bit harder here on the second map.
Taimu ready with the ult already, taking this fight against Tracer. One bullet would have done it, but it is not going to be quite enough. He ends up going down. Splyce, what is their ults like? They actually almost have 5 ults. If they can just sort of reset here and actually get everyone up and living, they will have a really big ult advantage against EnVy. And so just a slight, a minuscule reset here where they get everyone on the same part and they just don't run in staggered, they should be in a good position.
They have plenty of time, right? Exactly. Take your time, get the setup, get grouped, and let Clockwork try and find some kind of flank avenue as well. If he can actually get in here to try and harass the back line, that would be pretty nice. But there's the Graviton Surge, or he's ready with it. Sickness, when's he going to actually unleash it? Because his teammate has been boosted up, and so far it's just a fair trade on both sides.
Sickness not using his ultimate yet, so still got that in the back lines here. They got two kills already on EnVy. Harry Hook is going to be going down. Where's that ult coming in? There it is. Sickness putting in the Graviton Surge, and Shane charging through them, gets a double kill, Clockwork helping out, and that should be the end of it. He should be able to push on to the second or the final stage here. EnVy just getting out ulted, and they still have two ults up and running here. They still have the Earth Shatter and the Death Blossom on Shrugger.
Yeah, interesting decision there by Coco to use his Earth Shatter. I mean, he was the last man alive. There wasn't a whole lot that he was going to do. I mean, is it worth it trading it for, like, the extra 3 seconds that it will take to push that payload in there? Still, EnVyUs. Now it's Tailspin on the far. He was doing so much damage on Numbani with this character, with the rockets. And, again, there isn't really the long-range poke here on Splyce. I mean, it comes down to pure if he can hit some shots with the Ana to try and pick Tailspin off.
Got to get into that last point here. pushing it around the corner. Got about 2 minutes. And Tailspin now up on the high ground, doing a lot of damage with those rockets, shooting some shielded targets. I'm not quite sure that's worth it. There's the Death Blossom in the background. Shrugga only picking up one kill behind it. That is not quite enough. And Tailspin here, almost with the ult. It's ready. Can they stop him if he puts it in? He's now targeting the supports, getting close to Ana in the background. Pure really having a hard time. He needs someone to help him out. And finally, Splyce able to do it. Sickness turning around on that Saria and getting a good couple of kills in.
Harry trying to buy a little bit more time there, challenging on the point, but that's not going to happen. Splyce now, they've got everything going their way at this point. They even have a couple of ult. Well, no, they have one ultimate that's about to kick off here with Ninja, and Sickness has almost got the Graviton, so they can just back off, buy a little bit more time. They still have a minute to set this push up. In the meantime, EnVyUs, Tailspin, he's sitting on his rocket, so we'll see if he can actually make it work.
Trying to see if they can make the push through. Charge comes in, and that's an instant kill. And that was the ult gone. The sound barrier instantly destroyed. And Tailspin coming through with a massive ultimate, taking down the remaining Splyce players. And that leaves them just 55 seconds here. An absolute reckoning.
Dude, it's when you get that barrage that's just boosted by Harry Hook. You know, it's total and utter annihilation. You're not going to live through it. Tailspin just does too much damage, and now he's once again getting boosted by Harry, just chucking those rockets around the choke. Eventually, Splyce are going to have to try and push through here and try and dodge as much of this damage as possible. You have to also keep in mind, though, that this is giving a lot of energy, basically, for the Ana ult, and Pure, he's ready for it. No, he dies! They managed to get the key pick on Pure!
That's definitely going to be a big problem. Coco picking up three big kills, but now comes the Graviton Surge in, return into the revive, and Envy just dropping Splyce once again. Look how close it is. They're almost at the point, but they only have 10 seconds left. Oh, Splyce, they're really putting up a great fight here against Envy, but it just doesn't seem to be enough.
So much interest in Pure, just dying quickly. Tailspin again. Shrugger is gone. He's got another barrage ready and waiting, and he just unleashes it, and there's just not enough time for Splyce to get around that corner and get on the point.
I feel like it's incredibly unfortunate that that charge, or it's really good skill on the Envy Reinhardt, but either way, the fact that it charges the just charges the sound barrier, so they can't even put it out. Lucio not getting any chance at all. That's going to be two maps for Envy here.
Just brutal play coming in from Envy. Pretty much what we expected to see. They're one of the favorites to make it deep in the tournament. I mean, last event tournament, they made it to the finals to play against Rogue. And here, once again, they're just looking in fine shape. And you can tell that they're just looking very crisp at this point. They've had 2 weeks of boot camp. And even at the very bitter end there, they were able to put up a very solid defense with some good team play.
Yeah, I like the diversity in heroes, though. I mean, we did sort of start off with the heavy tank meta, but both teams are willing to swap out of it whenever they needed to. You know, they didn't just sort of stick with it and say this is the only thing that works. A really incredible play. I look forward to seeing the breakdown of this. We'll go back to the analyst desk right after a break.
Hello, welcome back to the Overwatch Open. We just saw our first match that was between EnVyUs and Splyce. Guys, the first map played out just like you would say, but that second map on King's Row, we saw a bit more of a game. So let's do a deep dive on Numbani first. Chris, do you want to talk to us a little bit about what you saw?
Pretty straight to the point. I mean, what happened, happened. We knew it was going to happen. It's a sad story. All in all, I feel like, you know, EnVyUs came out very strong. The Pharah pick. Like,
The pharmacy was open.
Yeah. Do you think the Pharah pick's something they want to do long term, or are they just doing it because it's Splyce? You know, it's like, you know, we have some games to play with here.
Well, here's the thing. Tailspin is one of the best Pharahs in the game. Arguably, in many people's eyes, the best Pharah in the game. When Pharah was all the rage in the meta, that was a big reason why Envy was doing well. And I think they're very eager to jump back on Pharah when they have the opportunity. And now in the meta that we have right now, our teams aren't always running a McCree. It depends on the team. Some teams going, maybe we'll run a Tracer instead. Mm-hmm. If you don't have the threats to take down a Pharah, and you can throw a nano boost
they
on
the
Pharah.
They had the threats, though. They had the McCree. It's just a fact of...
Well, they switched to McCree later on, though. It wasn't one of those things where they immediately went to it. And it's one of those things where they're not practiced with it. It's different than when you're running McCree all the time, where you throw it in afterwards, like, oh, we just have to do this to deal with the Pharah. You're making the other team switch up and play your game. And that's brutal. So if Envy can keep running that well, it's going to be great. Also, Tailspin's May. Awesome.
It was refreshing to see, and actually we're very lucky we have a Tailspin up in the coop with Malik. So Malik, tell me what this pro player was thinking.
Hey guys, I am here with Tailspin indeed. Dude, that was a complete and total wash, at least from my perspective. So were you guys prepared for the four tank two support comp, or when you saw it ahead of time?
Yeah, there's been a lot of teams running that comp lately. It really fits the meta, so we've gotten a lot of experience playing with and against it.
Yeah, and you know what? I noticed there's been a lot of people running a 3-3 comp too. Is that something you guys are comfortable doing yourselves?
Oh yeah, you kind of just have to do it nowadays. On certain maps and certain objectives, it's just the way to go. It's the strongest cup you can run most of the time.
All right, cool. So we saw a little bit of May from you. We saw a little bit of Pharah. That May, this is the first time I've actually seen you run a May. Is that something that you've become comfortable doing?
Yeah, well, he actually used May for the first time on King's Row about like a month ago when it wasn't too strong, but May, just the wall on that map is always useful. It's just nowadays with so many tanks, May just is a little more popular. So a lot of teams have been using May more frequently, and especially on King's Row.
Gotcha. You know, you guys were firing on all cylinders. It almost seemed like you guys were a step ahead of the opposite team the entire match. Who you get most of your information from? Who's like the shot caller on your team?
We actually don't really have a shot caller. It just mostly depends on what our game plan is at that time, whenever the fight's going to happen. If someone has a certain ultimate or we want to do a certain play, we just kind of make it up on the fly. Mostly, I would say if we had to pick a shot caller, it'd be Harry, just because speed boost is so like important.
Yeah.
And he's really good at just knowing when to use it and when to initiate.
Right, man. Well, you know what? I'm looking forward to seeing a lot more of you guys. Good luck to you guys for the rest of the tournament, man. And thank you very much for talking to us, man.
Thank you.
Back to the desk.
All right. Thanks for those insights, Malik. Great job, Tailspin. Now, we do have some highlights from map one. So I want to pull these up here as we chat about that performance on Numbani, because Tailspin with Harry Hook was doing some work. I mean, that was a stronghold. They didn't even let them, Splyce get that first point. So we should see how the magic went down.
Yeah, it's just the power of Nano Boost, having a Pharah, doing so much damage, comboing alts, that ult management we were talking about earlier.
And what you saw going in, too, is that just in general, Envy was playing these teams fight smarter. They weren't having to use as many ults. They were able to go in. And, of course, where it was Tailspin on May or Tailspin on Pharah, huge impact. But let's not forget about Taimu. Taimu on Roadhog was able to land key picks early on these fights. And then you see this fight right here. He landed two early picks. There's nothing that Splyce could do at that point. They were just completely outgunned.
Yeah, and Internet Hulk doing, of course, a great job on Winston. What he's primarily known for, it's kind of unusual, though, at the same time, don't you think? A little bit, Taimu playing the Roadhog. I just want to point to the fact, I honestly think this is them saying, you know what, this is Splyce, this is a lower-end team. We're going to do what we want, we're going to do what we please, and you can see that Taimu just a power to be reckoned with. He's just constantly in the air, not being challenged.
That was my favorite moment there with Pharah getting the boost from on.
That's just scary, where you're already down players and Pharah's coming in with a boost. It's not fun times. But I will say this, it's not too uncommon to see your McCree player, which of course Taimu plays a lot, swap to Roadhog. That's been the back and forth, because they're both characters, even though one's a tank and one's a DPS, they both have the ability to burst people down very quickly, and having someone in that role is important. But it really was the Tailspin to Taimu show for so much of this, and it was beautiful to behold, especially if you're a fan of Pharah.
Yeah, Numbani was It was honestly brutal. I mean, even here, they're fighting for what they can. At this point, though, you're just staggering yourself. You're just making it a lot worse. EnVyUs, they didn't look too happy with that win either. I mean, I think for them, it's business as usual. They're saying, you know what, we are one of the favorites in this whole tournament. You know, forget this first game. Mm-hmm. We need to come out here strong, and we need to send a message to these other teams.
Well, I was just happy to see they weren't rejoicing in that win. No. They know that this is just the first step on a long climb here.
That's one of the things that you can judge teams, though, especially if they're a favorite, where how are they dealing with the teams that aren't favorites? Are they just barely scraping by, or are they being dominant? And for the most part here, Envy was dominant, and that's a very good sign for them going forward into the tournament.
I don't think they were as dominant as they could be, though. I mean, on that second map, King's Row.
Yeah, that's actually a perfect lead-in, Chris. Map 2, King's Row. We really, you know, we expected that to be pretty quick as well. You know, Envy started off on attack. They set a great time, and then Splyce gets a hold of that cart, and oh my god, it's like right down to that last couple inches before that final checkpoint, and we're still fighting.
I think this is a really interesting point. We saw a lot of times that almost every time EnVyUs just nano boost, they either do Reaper or they do, you know, the Pharahs, the skinnier characters. For the most part, especially in pub games, you're always going to send it to those tankier characters, but they're so big, they have a big target on their head, especially when there's an Ana on the other side. They can always send that dart. They can always put them to sleep. When they're skinnier, faster, they're going to be harder to hit.
The other thing, too, it's high risk, high reward there, where you throw it on the tank is always going to give you space and always let you move in. You throw it on a McCree, you throw it on a Reaper or otherwise, these are easier characters to take down, but if you can make the most of your damage side of that Nana boost, you can do terrible damage, and that's what Tyra was able to do, certainly, when he got Nana boost.
I think primarily it's more about the disables, you know? You're going to be able to hit a lot of hooks, you're going to be able to hit a lot of darts, you're going to be able to disable those big tanks. Our Reaper's going to be a little bit quicker, it's going to be a little bit skinnier, harder to hit.
I mean, I agree there to some extent that the disables are certainly a big deal, but I think part of it is that they trust that you throw the nano boost on Tailspin or throw the nano boost on Taimu that they are going to get the job done, and not every team can rely on that, because if you throw your nano boost on DPS and they're not hitting their shots, they're not doing what they need to do, it's a much bigger waste than just throwing on a tank that at the very least is a big wall of meat.
As Rachel was saying earlier, we see a lot of momentum here from them at the end. Splyce actually came very, very close to finishing this map. And for me, that's a win for them. I put that as like, you know what? You did pretty well against EnVyUs. How well would, honestly, NRG or Team Liquid do? You kind of put that in their mindsets. You know, as pro gamers, you don't want to beat yourself up. You have a whole group to still play out. And you say, we did well against the top dog. Going into these next matches, we might actually have a real shot because we came close in the second King's Row. They have like a consolation prize.
They also had heroics there from Clockwork too, and big parts of King's Row where he was able to get into the backline's Tracer, get picks, not let Envy fully reset up their defense at points and sort of keep them on the back foot. And Clockwork, if Splyce is going to do on this tournament, if they're going to bounce back, get out of groups, they're going to need Clockwork to do that and more going forward, because they do need just someone to be the hero for their team and make those opportunities. And for Splyce, they might have fallen to EnVyUs here in this first match, but they are still alive and they still have chances later on in the tournament.
Yeah, I do want to say Clockwork doing a lot of work for his team there, and actually moments of brilliance come from all these Splyce players. Mm-hmm. It's almost like they just need to kind of unify that, because Sickness, again, on Zarya was doing fantastic. Last one alive, holding that point on Nubani, making some killer plays right there at the end of King's Row. So
I think it was a good version of Splyce. I think EnVyUs, they're just getting warmed up.
That's true. And you know what? Everyone here can take their time, because this was just the first match of the Overwatch Open. We have so much more coming for you today. Up next, it's going to be NRG versus Liquid. Guys, NRG in the home of Shaq here at Turner. It's going to be incredible to see them play. I hope Seagull is excited, because I know so many of the other players are keeping their eye on him.
Yeah, it's like you want to make Dad proud. You know, you're here at the home game. He's got to do something.
Absolutely.